Hi everyone, Wolf Branch Homestead here with our first video following along with an idea I've had for several years. I wanted to start doing some book recommendations and book reviews for you all, whether it be books about self-sufficiency, homesteading, or other interesting topics. And I finally just got back into reading more, and I wanted to share a book with you to start this off that I think you might be interested in. This book is called The Cheese Chronicles by Liz Thorpe, and this is all about American cheese producers, not the big factories that produce all that shelf-stable stuff you see in the market, in the plastic packaging, the common names. This is about the smaller groups, the farms, the small-scale people in some cases. This is about American cheesemakers. Now, what better way to show this than to be out here with our goats as they browse? I just finished this book and wanted to talk about it a little bit, show you some of the things inside, and kind of give my overall opinion on this. So, I got into learning more about cheese kind of by sheer accident. I was just looking at types of cheeses to try on different things, and I started seeing all these very unfamiliar names, things I hadn't heard of before. I grew up, you know, going to the supermarket and just getting cheddar, mozzarella, and Parmesan, things like that. But I started seeing names that I was not familiar with at all. Really didn't have an expanded palate. I kind of just stuck to the same things. And it got me into researching them more. This is a few years back. And when I started looking all of this up, I came across some videos by Liz Thorpe talking more about these cheeses. She's got years of experience, not only just with American cheeses, but with those from other countries as well. And I got so interested in learning more about the different styles, the textures, the taste, where they came from, that for the longest time, I had her books on my wish list. There's a few different books, but this one in particular I wanted to start off with because I found it to be a good starting point for cheeses from home, if that makes sense. She has, again, a few different books that she's worked on. There's one that's a bigger hardback guide, but I had the opportunity to actually get a used copy for a really good price. And this is actually, if we look here, this is a first edition copy from 2009. Now, I love giving a good used book a home. There's something about it. I've always had a fascination with used books finding their way to another place. So that's usually what I do, is pick up used books. And I, again, got this one for a really good price. You can support directly the sales by your author that you're, you know, looking to read a book by. You can go and purchase something as a new copy off of their website, off of a major retailer website. You can also buy a used copy like I did and support somebody, you know, that might be a small scale reseller, and this is how they go about their job, basically, where they'll pick up books like this and resell them. And that's what we did, is we got a used copy off of eBay. Or if you really don't want to commit to buying a book, well, if you don't already have a card for your local library, go down there and see if maybe they have a copy available. I used to love going to the local library, but now I like to pick up books to actually keep. So a lot of the time I'll kind of research what I want to read, or I'll find something at a yard sale, and that's kind of how I'll find my books. And I've been looking all over for this one and haven't found it until now, and again, got a good deal on this, so I'm really happy. Now here's our contents page. It's trying to flip over with the wind. And you'll see in the beginning here, you've got a few forwarding notes. You've got some introduction pages by the author. And you're learning about times where she's went to the actual farms to get hands-on with the cheese-making process. Going and visiting with the Amish folks and learning more about their cheese making. There's even a section about how these factories and these large-scale producers that you see at the supermarket, how they differ and kind of how they came about. How people started off with cheese in America. And you're even going to learn about people that raise goats and sheep, not just cattle. You also learn a little bit about the differences between animals that are strictly on pasture, or ones that are kind of half and half, or those that are barn kept. I hear you. There's a beautiful hawk family flying around. It's just a beautiful day. Our rain has finally ceased, and I think everybody's happy, including our goats. They're enjoying it outside. But you'll learn about why some farms that produce cheese or raise the animals that make milk and cheese. You'll learn why not only regional differences, but also consistency of the cheese play a role in whether they're pasture-based or they're, you know, in the barn. Some areas, you know, especially down south, if the weather's nice, they can keep them rotating on pasture all the time, even in the wintertime. Some areas, it's so cold, they can't do that. The animals have to come inside. And again, also the consistency of the cheese can be different if they're out rotating on different things, like goats, where goats will get out and browse, and they'll have different things that they browse on. It can affect the consistency and the taste, and some people will choose to have them inside to help have a reliable product that's the same every time, if that makes sense. Liz Thorpe will also talk about different cheeses from all over America. She'll introduce us to different farms and some of her favorite cheeses from those farms. And you'll get notes about what the shape and the appearance of the cheese is, what it smells like, the texture, the taste. There's also different sidebars in here with other information as well. Goodness. They're riding the wind around. It's so windy out today. Again, we've got to start off. We've got our acknowledgments from the author, and our forward pages. We'll flip over here. This isn't set up fancy. We're just out here in the woods with the goats, so I've got it propped up on my boot. There she goes. There's one particular place I want to get to here as I flip through. Hi, Yusuke. And I think it's on one of the sidebars. Flip through as we look at the goats here for just a moment. I think it's right here in the first chapter. I didn't have anything bookmarked here, There's a section, if I can find it. Let's see. There we go. There's a section here where she talks about how they introduced people to cheese tasting, and that you're using your senses. You're not just using your taste. You're using your eyes. You're looking and examining the cheese. Can you tell what it's going to be like based on the outside, the rind, the coloration? Use your nose and smell. Smell the aroma of the cheese. Cut it and smell it. And also use your taste. And you'll find that a lot of the descriptions given of different cheeses, I've tried a few now over the years, not too many, but just a few. And a lot of the descriptions that I see from these cheeses are pretty accurate as far as what to expect from taste and smell. And there's also information in here about different producers. Again, visiting with the Amish, visiting different farms. And you'll see different pages like this. After the main part of the chapter, you'll see where they will have a company's name and their location. And in bold, you'll see the names of the cheeses that she's mentioning, talking about, giving an opinion on, and also kind of describing in detail. So these are really handy sections here too. And there's information here about not just cow milk, but goat and sheep milk cheeses as well. And even when I did first start getting into this, I was a little more timid to try anything outside of cow's milk cheese. I just, you know, that's what I grew up with. Didn't ever try anything different, really. But this book actually made me really excited to go back and try cheeses from goat and sheep milk. And some of them are even hybrids. They'll have different types of milk too. We got into this chapter right here. It's 1982. Do you know where your goats are? And they're talking about some of the first people in America to really try and promote and make cheese made out of goat's milk. And just in general, some of the descriptions of the care taken with the goats and the sheer determination by the people making the cheese, it really made me excited to actually try them. I'm a lot more brave about that now. So I look forward to that. And some of the descriptions of the cheeses, their flavor profile, their appearance, really just makes me want to try them more now. So if you've ever been a little bit timid about trying any kind of cheese that's not made from cow milk, if you've been timid about trying anything with goat or sheep, then give this a read. It might change your mind. You can't eat the book, dude. I've spent a lot of time actually reading out here with the goats while they're browsing over the past couple days, and I've spent some time reading with the cats, and the cats like to get in my lap and try and taste the book, get up trying to bite the pages of it, and reading with them has been a good opportunity for them to just lay down and have a nap while I flip through a few pages here. There's even different sections talking about the use of frozen curd versus fresh curd, fresh milk, milk from the cheesemaker's farm, or milk from other dairies nearby. And I think one of my favorite chapters is actually here at the end. There's a section right before that where it's talking about more of the southern producers. And again, you're learning more about how the regional differences for the cheesemaker and the farm that produces the milk. You're learning how regional differences can impact if they're on pasture or if they're barn kept, things like that. But my favorite in all of this has been a chapter called Little Cheese. And these are the really small scale producers that are so local that a lot of the time their cheese doesn't make it outside of their farm, their local farmers market. That's where they sell to. And you'll see different places like that in here. Again, you've got the name of the producer, their location in bold are some of the suggestions made by the author. And I think that also, for somebody looking to try different cheeses, this is a really great way, by focusing on the small scale cheesemakers. I think it's a great way to encourage people. Maybe you live in one of these states, you travel a little bit. Maybe you want to travel and go visit where these farmers markets are. Maybe you want to take a road trip, and you can add some of these things on your map as you go through and stop by, maybe visit the farm. Some of them even had, there's one where they actually had people, they would sell tickets for like a Sunday dinner or Sunday breakfast, I think it was, and you could buy a ticket and you would eat meals with things that were completely off the land from their farm. Fresh vegetables, things made with the eggs from the chickens they raised, milk and cheese from their animals, things like that. And it was just so interesting because it provides an opportunity to support these small scale people and what they do, and also provide kind of a tourism boost for that area, and encourage people to try more of these. And I think even if you don't, we've got the mosquitoes out here trying to bite, but even if you don't live near these areas or plan to travel to them, maybe this will inspire you, like it has for me, to research cheesemakers near you, to visit your farmer's market if you have one, or travel a little bit and go to a farmer's market and see if you can find somebody making those cheeses. And I think having that in your head and having that idea, then go on to some of the other materials she has. Liz Thorpe has, again, another book about what they call the gateway cheeses, where she mentions some of the cheeses you might be more familiar with and things that are similar to those. And there's also, she's a co-writer on a book from Murray's Cheese with different tasting notes for different types of cheese, information about them, what they look like, their size, their flavor profile, things like that. And I think if you do a little more research onto what a good cheese will taste like and appear like, you can kind of build up your palate and then try those local cheeses, and you might be pleasantly surprised by just how good they are. Now again, it's been a few years since I've been able to actually kind of try some different ones. We are getting a town over. They are building a nice big new supermarket, without naming any names, that is known for carrying a lot of different cheese styles. And so while I am going to be trying types from different countries over time, I'm looking forward to possibly seeing some cheeses from American producers there. And again, not talking about the little plastic wrapped singles you get in the refrigerated section. Actual good for you cheese. I think that's one of the most exciting parts of the book. Again, I look forward to trying different types. That's one of the biggest things that I got from reading this, is an excitement to break away from the stereotypical over-processed junk that you see. Being excited to pair this with a lot of different local things and just make a really good meal out of it. There's a vineyard a few towns over, and it's been a long time since we've had anything from there. We actually had one of their wines when we got married, and I can't remember if they're still open or if that's the one that had closed down, but I feel like it would be really nice to go over to this local vineyard whenever we're over that way and get a bottle, and then try to go out, find a local farmer's market, get cheese from there, and pair them together, looking at some of the notes of what different types of cheeses would be good with. Get a little bit tongue-tied there. But just in general, looking forward to really diving into cheese. And I think when you get into books like this, again, I know this is our homestead channel, but we're talking about this because it is putting emphasis on putting better food into your body. And again, I know we probably have some folks here that are vegetarian, vegan, and I completely respect that. I understand where you're coming from. I do. And I hope that you have some really good local foods that you do enjoy. Maybe you're able to grow something yourself. And we'd love to hear about maybe some of the recipes that you have for vegan options, for vegetarian options. Some of the yummiest foods at times that I've eaten have been vegetarian or even vegan. Used to do a lot of vegan cooking years back. But this is for folks who maybe want to learn more about, I'm watching the goat here. She's really alert for some reason. Not sure what she's looking at. She might be seeing my husband. He was down at the shop earlier. I think that's what she might be looking at. Let's walk over here and see real quick. Hey guys, what's the matter? As you say. Oh, she doesn't see him. I don't know what she's looking at. She's not as keen on it, but Daddy Goat Kuwabara, he is really good about spotting snakes. So I'm just making sure that he also didn't pick up on whatever it was. Didn't see any kind of critters, so that's good. We'll go back to sitting down for a little bit longer and talking about the book here. But again, just... Huh? Give you a scratch, buddy. He likes to come up sometimes and get a pit, and he'll walk off and he'll come back over to you. And he, the daddy goat, he likes to pick things up. If you have a bag, you have a can or something like that, he'll try to pick anything up and just move it around, just because he knows that he's being mischievous. He'll look at you. You say something to him, you just go, like that. Like, don't do it. You get a different tone, and he knows. He'll make eye contact with you, and he'll just do it anyways. He's a crazy goat. But just in general, I think this is a good read if you want to explore food more, if you want to learn more about maybe local foods, you want to try different things, different recipes. I think this is a really good inclusion, not only to your own knowledge of reading it, especially, if you're just going to lease this from the local library, but if you do have a bookshelf and you really like to add different things to your bookshelf. Now, there's not any recipes in here, but you're going to learn from this. You're going to learn not only about food, but there's also even a section here at the end in the appendix that talks about common breeds that people use, not only cows, but goats and sheep as well. And you'll even see about that in some of the sections where certain farmers use certain breeds and what the reasoning is behind that. And you'll even see in here, as we get to the section on goat breeds, trying to flip with one hand, that's fun. Can't quite get it. There we go. But you'll even see in the goat section, Nubian goats. Now that is what the daddy, the really tall brown goat back there, he's a registered Nubian. Now, mom is a mixed breed. What'd you see, buddy? And Yusuke is their baby, so he's a mixed breed as well. But the Nubian is a really beautiful goat breed. That's what my grandmother raised when I was a kid. And I just absolutely love being around them. I loved how large the goats were, how they were built. And they just had a good personality. And so that's why, with him, that's what we chose. And you'll see even on there where it says it's the cutest with long floppy ears. Get that mosquito off of me. And that, he definitely has. He has those floppy ears. It's not a heavy milk producer, but has a high average butterfat content of 4 to 5%. The breeding season's much longer also, and so it's possible to produce milk year-round. I cannot read today. Apologies. But I wanted to get back to the section on Little Cheese. All of those local producers to you. And there's a section I wanted to read, if I can get through it without getting too tongue-tied. And that section really stuck with me in particular about wanting to find locally made cheese. Let's see. Now this is a pretty long book. This is actually towards the back in the Little Cheese section, but it's on page 306. The wind was blowing a little bit too much there. Let's try to start over here. I'm going to hold the book down in my lap where we can read this without too much impact by the wind blowing the pages over on us here. The Blue Jays are just chatting. But this is on page 306. And I think this description, this image in your mind of finding a good local cheese is just such a beautiful portrayal of seeking out that local cheesemaker. On an August Saturday in Belfast, Maine, when the sky is cerulean, the pine trees are straight, and the air whiffs of harbor, boat rope, and lobster shells. The sun is bright, but the air is cool. Maybe even broken cotton sweatshirt cool. And your belly is sated with a cup of coffee and that slab of pie you ate in a rocking chair. Hearing the buoys slap in the bay, your lap covered with an old quilt. On that Saturday, when you find the local goat cheese, lined up in knobby little rounds, some dusted with dried rosemary from the cheesemaker's garden, and the cheesemaker nods at you from the flatbed of his pickup truck. That goat cheese will be the most perfect cheese you have ever eaten. It will be an impeccable balance of moist squish and delicate acidic crumble. You will feel it smear under the pressure of your tongue into mouth-watery, lemony, sun-warmed, herby crumbs. It will be an epiphany, and you will laugh out loud and call your friend or mother or lover over and point to each imperfectly shaped lump, trying to decide which one. Which one do you want to buy? And what bread to spread it on? And which wine to savor? And soon, by 8:15 in the morning, that modest nugget of yesterday's milk will have planned your entire day. That is the power of the small local cheesemaker. That just beautiful portrayal of finding that cheese at a market, tasting a sample, and just debating which one do I take home. And then it inspires you, and your wheels in your mind are turning. What am I going to eat this with? Do I want to make some bread? Do I want to go out and try to find somebody who's baked some fresh bread? Do I want to go and pick out some local wine? Do I want to pair this with a homemade meal? Just the idea that food can take us on a journey. I think that's one of the most beautiful parts about this book. And again, I think this is a great book for anybody, not only if you're interested in trying new things, new cheeses, but just people in general that enjoy a good read. It's a great book to have, a great book to pick up. And again, whether you want to loan this from the local library, you want to pick up a used copy, or you want to pick up a new copy to help support the author, this is a really great addition, and I wanted to start off because I just really enjoyed this book. Again, this is The Cheese Chronicles by Liz Thorpe. A journey through the making and selling of cheese in America, from field to farm to table. The one I have in particular is a 2009 first edition. It is used, so you've got a little bit of markings on here, a little bit bent up. No writing in it though, which is a really good thing. If you do purchase used copies from somewhere like eBay, you can look at condition notes. You can look at pictures of the book, and that'll help you determine kind of what condition it's in. And pay attention to the description by the seller that will tell you any important notes you need to know. On the back here, you can see what the original cost was, the MSRP on the book. You can learn more about the cover design, a little bit about the author, and some information on the book itself and what you can expect to find inside. Also at the back here, not only do you have an index or an appendix for the different breeds, but you do also have an index of what pages different things are on, and it can help you refer back if there's something you wanted to look at again in the future, whether you want to go back and look at a particular farm. Now, this is from 2009, but some of the ones that interest me the most out of this book, ones that really describe something I would be interested in trying, I did look a few of those up, and those producers of the cheese were actually still around, and some of them even did ship. So you can look up some of these online and see if they're, you know, might still be around. And some of the ones I was really interested in were pretty seasonal, so you would have to check back with the farm, the producer, to see when their availability was. But I think it's a great way to get some ideas of what you want to try, inspire you to maybe check with Murray's. They do ship cheese. Again, because this is such an amazing product, cheese can be a little bit costly compared to what you're used to at the store, you know, the processed stuff. Hey, Photon. So, you'll see some varying prices, and again, a lot of that, especially these small-scale producers, there's a lot involved with this, and some of this is still done by hand, not entirely mechanized. So, again, you can order stuff online, but just be prepared for a little bit of sticker shock if you're not used to buying something like that, if you're used to just, again, the cheap slices in the store. For us, now we haven't ordered through Murray's yet, but they do have some options where you can look at stuff that might be out of stock because it is seasonal. But there's a lot of different options there, not just from America, but from other countries as well. Things you might be more familiar with. Again, they do have a lot of resources on their website where they talk about what to expect through different cheeses, and they also have the book that kind of tells you what to look for as well. But for us, I found that we haven't done it again in a few years. We're waiting on our supermarket here to open up a couple towns over, so when we go to get groceries or something like that, we can go by there. But we used to take and have a once a month date night where we'd pick a different food and we would sit down and try different things, try different cheeses, and cook up something nice, just sit down and enjoy a movie and enjoy some really awesome food. And that's where we started incorporating those cheeses. Now, I got to a point where we were a little more modest about not spending so much on stuff, but again, you can tell when you do start eating other things, when you start eating fresher things, not so just incredibly pumped with preservatives and things that make it last longer, you can tell the difference in taste. And there's a lot of cheeses that I've tried, like when I first got into trying brie. At first, I really didn't know what to expect. I really wasn't interested at first bite, but then I got into it, tried it a little bit more, found things to pair it with, and it just made it yummy. And there are some that you'll find, kind of like how it's described in here, like table cheeses. You'll find some that you can just eat straight up and just enjoy the flavor of. There are some described in here that are smoked cheeses, and I could just imagine having that, taking bites of that, having a little nibble, and just eating it by itself. It seems like it would be so delicious just to have on its own. But that's all for today. We'll definitely go about introducing you to some other favorite books as we read them. I'm a pretty quick reader. I do get through books fairly quickly. It only took me a little bit of time to go through this book, but I am pretty good at kind of retaining what I've learned from them and really being inspired by them enough to try to summarize it for you without spoiling it for you, if that makes sense. I wanted to show you a little bit of this book, but not spoil, rather excite you to read it, where you're inspired to pick it up and look through it for yourself. And we'll share lots of other books with you. I look forward to definitely sharing some helpful books, fiction and nonfiction. I recently read one that is based on a true story, kind of fictionalized book about a pilot in Alaska. Kind of in the style of a kid's book, but still, that was actually a yard sale find, and I was like, this looks pretty interesting, so I finally picked it up and read it a while back. And I might share that one. We'll probably go through and share some of the ones about things, whether it be tanning, training animals. One of the things I would really like to share about would be the journal entries compiled into a book by Richard Prenicke, who I believe he was in his 50s when he actually moved up to Alaska and built his own log cabin and lived up there. And he also took lots of videos of it at the time, and it was one of the first things that really helped me to love Alaska as it was and the beauty of it. And hopefully one day we'll be able to make it up there and have a visit. But even not just Alaska, just the pioneering spirit, the do-it-yourself spirit, I think was just such a interesting thing to see. So we'll share more with you. We hope that this simple little outdoor visit with the goats, while talking about a new favorite book, will be enjoyable for you. Hope that you enjoyed it. Again, if you haven't met them before, that's Kuwabara right there, the tall fella. That's the daddy. In the background back there is Botan. That's Mama Goat, and this is their baby, Yusuke. And I think it's a wonderful thing to get out here with them and read while they're browsing a little bit. Keep an eye on them. They seem to like it too. They'll come over and check on what I'm doing every so often. And it's also a good way to sit down with the kitty cats while they're taking a nap. Sorry, trying to adjust the way I was holding this here. But it's a good way to sit down and spend some time with the kitty cats too. Read a good book with a kitty cat curled up.
And we hope that
this style of a review for our first video is enjoyable for you. I know it's going to be kind of long, but hopefully it kind of encompasses the whole of the book without spoiling anything for you, where you'll know kind of what's included. And maybe, again, it will inspire you to try some new cheeses and visit the farmer's market, pick some up, or visit that supermarket and see what they have to offer that might have been mentioned in this book. Or look online and see if maybe you can pick some up from the farms yourself. It's a beautiful, windy day. Plane going over there. But thanks for joining us. We hope you enjoyed it, and we hope you're having a great day. And if it's not great so far, I hope it improves for you. And as always, until the next video or live stream, we hope you'll take care until then.